Experiment 3 in CHEM 1310 is titled Two Challenges Using Stoichiometry in the Mole, and there are two major parts to this experiment. In the first part, we're going to perform a synthesis of alum from aluminum cans, and the goal will be to synthesize 10 grams of product. To prepare this reaction and actually get the desired yield of product, we need to plan and use the right molar ratios of reactants. So a big part of the first part of the experiment is performing these stoichiometry calculations properly so that we get the desired yield of product. The second part of the experiment involves determining the stoichiometric coefficients associated with the oxidation of iron metal by copper sulfate. And here, there are two different oxidation states, +2 or +3, that can be accessed by the iron metal. And our goal is to determine which of these oxidation states is the one that's actually involved in the product. Believe it or not, we can use stoichiometry to do this by using the right ratios of reactants and examining carefully the products that are formed. So I wanted to begin by briefly talking about the reaction involved in alum synthesis, as well as a little bit about the stoichiometry calculations involved in planning to make sure that we get the desired amount of product. So the reaction involved is 2 moles of aluminum, which we'll get from aluminum cans, sanded off to remove paint and any other sealants on the surface, reacting with 2 moles of potassium hydroxide, 4 moles of sulfuric acid, and 22 moles of water to form 2 moles of alum and 3 moles of hydrogen gas. And the formula of alum you can see near the top of this slide is KAlSO42.12H2O. Now, from the problem statement in the lab manual, we know that we'd like to synthesize 10 grams of alum. The question is, how do we know how much of each reactant to use to give the amount of alum that you see right here? Well, there are sort of 3 steps we need to take to get those masses. The first is to convert that 10 grams of product that we want into moles. And we can do that using the molar mass of alum, which is easily calculated by looking up the average atomic weights of its constituent atoms in the periodic table. And don't forget to include the waters of hydration there. Once we've got the moles of alum product in hand, we can then use the molar ratios of each reactant to that alum product to figure out the number of moles of each reactant that we need to synthesize the desired 10 grams of alum. Here, molar ratios refers to a ratio of the stoichiometric coefficients involved. So, for example, the molar ratio between potassium hydroxide and alum is 2 to 2, or just 1. The molar ratio of sulfuric acid to alum is 4 to 2, or 2 overall. Once we know the moles of each reactant we need to get the desired mass of alum that we started with, we can convert each of those moles back into mass using the appropriate molar mass in grams per mole, or just multiplying the number of moles by the molar mass. I didn't indicate it here, but in the lab manual you'll see that excesses of some reagents are necessary. Don't forget to multiply each either number of moles or mass or volume by the appropriate factor indicated in the lab manual. So for example, if we need 3 times excess of potassium hydroxide, multiply the molar equivalent amount by 3 to get the amount needed for the actual reaction. One other thing that's worth mentioning is that the sulfuric acid will be a solution, so we'll need to use concentration in moles per liter to convert from the number of moles to a volume of solution that we can add. After mixing up all of the reactants and letting the reaction sit for a time, we'll end up with a solution of aluminum ions, potassium ions, and sulfate ions. And the question arises, how do we isolate the solid alum product from this solution? The technique we'll use in this experiment is called crystallization, and it's an extremely common and extremely useful technique for separating solids out of a liquid solution. The basic idea rests on the principle that the solubility of solids in liquids decreases as we lower the temperature, and so we can cause solids to precipitate out of solution simply by cooling them down in a lot of cases. In this case, we have a very concentrated solution of K+, Al3+, and SO42-. So as we cool down the solution using an ice bath, what starts to happen is the ions start finding each other and forming solid crystals on the sides of the reaction vessel, in our case, a beaker. So what you'll start to see after you've placed the solution in an ice bath for a time is solid will start to form on the sides of the beaker. And this solid is in crystalline form. It's a regular array of the K plus, Al3 plus, and SO4 2 minus ions. We can then filter this now heterogeneous mixture of liquid and solid to isolate the solid from the liquid. If we've done our jobs correctly, then the mass of solid alum should be approximately 10 grams. Although if it's less than 10 grams, we know that we obtained less than 100% yield. In the second part of this experiment, it'll be up to you to elucidate the stoichiometric coefficients associated with the reaction between iron solid and copper 2 sulfate, or CuSO4. The solid iron will be mixed with the aqueous copper sulfate and will get one of two possible products out. If you look at iron on the periodic table, you'll notice that it has access to a number of different oxidation states. Two of the most common are iron plus 2 and iron plus 3, so both the iron plus 2 and iron plus 3 ions can exist. This means that when we mix iron solid with aqueous copper sulfate, two possible things can occur. On the one hand, we could form iron 2 plus sulfate, FeSO4, and copper solid. But on the other hand, we could alternatively form iron 3 plus sulfate, which has the somewhat bigger molecular formula Fe2SO43 along with copper solid. Now you should notice immediately that both of these equations are lacking stoichiometric coefficients and may not be balanced. So the first step in attacking this problem is really to balance the two possibilities. So take a minute to balance these equations to give yourself a solid foundation for solving this problem. With the two balanced equations in hand, you can constrain what the possibilities are. And from here, it'll be up to you to design an experiment involving using the right masses of reactants and measuring the mass or potentially making other observations of the products to figure out whether iron 2 plus sulfate or iron 3 plus sulfate is actually formed. And here are a couple of things to consider. First of all, consider whether you can visually get an indication of the presence of copper 2 plus in the solution. You can look this up a bit beforehand, but when you get into the laboratory and start making up solutions, you'll definitely see that there is a visual indication of the presence of copper 2 plus ions in solution that doesn't exist for any of the other reactants or products here. Secondly, think about the possible molar ratios of the reactants. So these are going to be different for the two different chemical equations. I've drawn both arrows coming from Fe and CuSO4, but the stoichiometric coefficients on the reactant side will be different for the two possibilities. Think about those possible molar ratios in either case and how you can exploit the difference between them to potentially figure out which reaction is operating. You might also think here a little bit about the concept of limiting reagent, and how the limiting reagent is going to depend on those stoichiometric coefficients as well as the masses and number of moles of reactants that you decide to use. Finally, once you've chosen a particular molar ratio of reactants to run with, think about the expected total mass of solids at the end of the reaction and the composition of that mass. Are you expecting all of the iron to be completely consumed to form only copper metal? Or are you expecting a mixture of copper metal and iron, and how much of each are you expecting, and what's the total? You can use filtration to separate the solids from the liquid and mask the solid, and that's been a powerful strategy, but you'll want to plan here to know how much solid you should expect given both possibilities.